Quando entrou no chutou?
É. Vai dar sorte.
Okay, good evening everybody. Can you hear me? Can you hear me well? Okay. I'm Simone Rabutti from Radical Geek. I work as a machine learning engineer. And today I will introduce you to the problem of distributed computing. In particular, we will see a few tools that have been developed in the last 15 years to do data processing on a distributed system. Okay. Sorry? Okay. What is distributed computing? It's what you do when a single machine is not enough to do what you need to do. A single machine has a limitation in terms of CPU and RAM, and many of you probably experienced this in their daily routine, both for programming or the use of your PC for personal reasons. So, when we do machine learning, we want to create big models with expensive computations, and your local machine at a certain point will reach the limit. So the industry, in the last years, invented the mainframe that is the solution to this problem, a bigger computer. Clearly, this is not the solution, it is considered a failure, an architectural failure for many reasons. There is a solution to this today, is the cluster. A cluster is a system composed of many machines that cooperate to execute a task. We can see the general definition this way. And to work on a cluster, we need to be aware that there are many machines, and this is complex. Before I go on, I would like to explain the difference between parallel computing and distributed computing, because many people that don't work with distributed system often confuse the two concepts that are partially overlapping but are not the same thing. Parallel computing is when you have many tasks and you run them on multiple machines or multiple cores, and the tasks are extremely similar among them. An example for whoever you that works with machine learning, hyperparameterization is an example of an easily parallelizable task. You can run a different model on every core, on every machine, and then you get the best model according to some metric, and you're good. You can do that on multiple machines, that is parallel distributed computing. If you are on a local machine with multiple cores, it's simply parallel. Distributed computing is something more, it's more general. It's when you have a single problem, a single task, and you want to split the task and run the task on multiple machines. Clearly, this changes the workflow, the algorithm. It's complex, but it's what you are supposed to do with a distributed system. Okay. So, the real problem of a distributed system is, as I said, there are many machines, and you need to program those machines to work together. And that's something out of reach for most programmers. It's really difficult. For that reason, in the last 15 years, if many tools were developed to allow any programmer to work with a cluster, to work in a distributed manner. First of all, came that was born as an open source project, starting from a series of papers published by Google that documented their internal solutions. And this is still one of the big players in the distributed processing engines world. Because Hadoop was composed of three main components, HDFS, that is a distributed file system that allows you to store your files on multiple machines with all the guarantees of consistency and resiliency and so on. MapReduce, that we will see right now, and Yarn, that is the resource manager, basically the component in charge of taking your job, the job you want to execute, and split it among multiple machines. MapReduce is what is called a computational model. It's the way we define programs in MapReduce. As the name implies, there are two big phases in MapReduce, map and reduce. So you express the calculation you want to do in terms of map and reduce that are not to be confused with the functional operations of map and reduce that are the same name but are not the same thing. So I will try to explain briefly what how MapReduce works and how a program what a program has to deal with when working with MapReduce. As I said, there are two phases. The first is map, in which you take the raw input and you send an output, a pair composed of a key and a value. Then there are this phase, all the outputs generated with the same key are put together, sent to the same machine, and processed there. From the other space comes the final output. You can iterate over this and repeat the map and the other spaces. To express more complex programs have been developed many tools like Scalding or Hive or many others that translates your program in terms of map and reduce. Because working directly with MapReduce is complex for many applications. Okay. Today, Hadoop is an industrial standard. It's something you expect to see in any company that works with data before 2010 at least, but even after, it's everywhere. It's still supported and developed, and many features are released. But it lost its traction because for many applications, it is too slow, too complex, hard to maintain, some of that happened because of Yarn. And so it's still in use for many old-fashioned use cases, but it's not adopted by many people right now. It works well with batch processing. If you have a huge volume of data and you don't care about latency, you can produce your result after hours. For many applications, it works well. The other problem of Hadoop is iterative algorithms. I forgot to say that map between any map and audio space, everything is written to disk in the native Hadoop. So it's slow for many iterative applications because every time you have to write to disk. To solve this problem, Spark was born, and because Spark is the spiritual successor of Hadoop, if you want, it's the new industry standard, and it got a lot of traction because it works mainly in memory, and because you don't have only map and reduce, but you have a more complex computational model. You can express a more general computation easily. We will see it right now, and because of many other good features like the API that is Spark supports Java, Scala, Python, R, SQL, and it can integrate with many graphical tools and so on. Also, its success is to its success contributed many out of the box libraries that are included in the project. The project started actually as a demonstration for Mesos, that is the equivalent of Yarn, but better. It handles the resources of the cluster, but they saw it was so cool that eventually it became an independent project. A company was born to work on Spark, and it's a database that actually supports the framework together with the Lightpad. They are young guys from Berkeley. Okay, let's see the equivalent of map and reduce for Spark. You can only connect the dots because it's way different. The basic abstraction in Spark is the RDD. The RDD is a good thing that allows you to write audio programs on as transformations of RDDs. An RDD is a collection. It's a collection distributed on many nodes, but you write your transformations using modalic computation. I won't explain here, but basically it's like working on a local list. You define function transformation on this data, and Spark does the rest. So. An example, a really simple example, maybe this is a symbolic computation written in Spark through what is called the DAG, a graph of computation. You have a source that here is in green, that maybe the definition of where your data is. You can take it from a file, from a database, from whatever you want. You define a series of transformation, filter, map, reduce, join. There are tools to define SQL-like operations and so on. And then you define sync, where you want to put your data. Collect is to retrieve the data locally on the master node that runs the program. And you work with that. You can mostly ignore the underlying distribution of the data. You can ignore that you have different machines, you have different environments. Clearly, if you want to optimize your job, your program, you need to be aware, at least partially, of how the cluster is composed. But if you want to sketch a program and run it, this is effortless. And that's a big improvement over loop and over custom solution that that is important because this is the basics of the big data revolution. Without that you couldn't spend 2 years to write a custom framework to coordinate all the machines to do a single job. Here you have a general model and you can write your own programs from that. Okay, today's Spark, as I said, is the new industry standard. We can consider it a major tool. It just released its 2.0 version. And it's the go-to solution for most applications. Because it works better than Hadoop on everything. And it's faster, it's way faster. It's general, so if you know what your company will do with data, probably you want Spark because it's strong on almost everything. It has a lot of libraries for any kind of problem. There is an enormous community working on it. So for you know, general purposes and common applications, this is the best tool ever. Okay, let's talk about Flink. I will talk about Flink also later, but I'm talking to you. Flink was born almost at the same time as Spark, but got traction only recently because the industry is shifting towards streaming applications. And Spark doesn't really support streaming. It has what is called a mini batch mode. So basically, small batches of data, fast batches of data, but this has a latency in the order of half a second if you really want to push it. And that's not what streaming systems are doing right now. If you want to process millions of events per second, you can do that on Spark, but you have another latency. If you want the latency in the orders of milliseconds, you need different systems. And Flink is getting famous because it can handle an high throughput with a low latency and a full tolerance model that is called the Zappi ones. That means even if the system fails, you don't have replications of data or missing data. That's cool. And Flink achieves that using many complex abstractions and systems that it's out of scope of the talk of today. And as I said, it's getting traction because of what are called the fast data application. Fast data is when you want to process a huge collection of data and you want to do it in real time. Well, real time means low latency, the orders of milliseconds. So many companies like Zalando, Alibaba, and many others are using it in production. So it just released its first version, but it's better enough for Alibaba, for example, to be in production with clusters of thousands of machines. It's mainly picked over Spark when you have this process requirement. You want a fast answer to your event fast reactions. Okay, I will briefly mention a few other tools that are competing mainly with Flink, but have the potential to compete also with Spark. Apache Storm, well, this is specifically for streaming. It can handle high throughput, but it's the fastest system you can have right now. Apache Samza, Apache Beerbomb, and Apache Apex have mostly the same specification. I think they work well on the same use cases, but Samza has some issues with fault tolerance, while Beerbomb and Apex are just younger, they may get traction later on in the following years. Okay, I'm done. After this talk, Gianmarco will talk about how to develop a recommender system on Spark, and that is the king application of Spark right now, because everybody wants a recommender system.